Today marks the eighth month since the war in Gaza erupted. With no clear end in sight for the conflict, negotiations for a ceasefire continue. We're now joined by Israel's ambassador to the Philippines, Ilan Floss. Mr. Ambassador, good afternoon. Thank you very much for talking to us.
Good afternoon, Ron, and thank you for having me over here in the program, and hello to the viewers.
Hi, sir. We have to first talk about that recent strike in that school in central Gaza, which reportedly left dozens of civilians dead. What is Israel's side to that story? Why was that operation essential to this battle, and Israel's reaction to the UN statement and the civilians killed?
So, Ron, thank you very much for the question. I think it's important to hear the Israeli side, because the reports we are getting from Gaza are coming from Ministry of Health of Gaza, which is actually the Ministry of Health of Hamas. It's a terror organization. The current situation and what happened specifically in this incident, we're talking about a school where the Hamas operatives had one of the side headquarters. We know that they were using three classrooms for the terrorist operations. The terrorists that were there were between 30 to 40 Hamas terrorists there. Some of them were involved directly in the October 7 attack against Israel. Israel has used precise intelligence and information before the attack. We even delayed the attack a couple of times in order to minimize and prevent civilians from getting involved. Mm-hmm. And the ammunition itself, which was chosen, was accurate, precise, and also smaller explosives in order to minimize the civilian suffering. But it is important to say, it's a school of UNRWA, but it is used by Hamas. And we're claiming this from the beginning of the operation. Hamas is using schools, hospitals, mosques, and other humanitarian institutions for their terror attacks against Israel. By that, this building or compound is becoming a compound of terrorism. So they are using human shields, and we are calling for them to stop attacking Israel, stop using human shields, and recognize that terrorism is not the way forward.
Despite the Hamas using this tactic of using human shields and hiding in schools and hospitals and mosques where civilians stay, in this war you have with Hamas, is Israel making a real effort in avoiding civilians from being hurt and killed?
Absolutely. IDF is working according to international law. The soldiers and officers are guided also by legal advisors. Now, I can show you footage of an attack which took place 10 days ago against the Hamas operative. This attack against the specific operatives who was a terrorist was postponed a couple of times, and we have the footage showing that there was a child next to him, and we did not attack until the cameras of the drones showed us that the child was moving away and the terrorist was alone. So we are doing what we can in order to minimize non-involved people and civilians to be affected and involved. Now, we have to understand, it's a war which was initiated by the terror organization Hamas, attacking Israeli civilians, and they are continuing until now to target not only Israeli soldiers, but Israeli communities. Just a few days ago, they launched more rockets from Gaza onto communities in Israel. So we're dealing with a terror organization, and it's a real challenge. We are doing as much as we can in order to minimize the involvement of people who are not connected to the Hamas.
From the efforts of war to efforts of peace, U.S. President Joe Biden has made mention of an Israeli proposal to end the conflict in Gaza, starting with a ceasefire and a possible exchange of hostages and prisoners. What's the latest on that front, sir, and how has Hamas responded to it?
So, of course, from here, I'm not directly involved in the negotiations, and a lot of details behind the scenes, which we do not know. However, it's reported that Hamas has said no to the proposal of President Biden, which was coordinated with Israel and also with the negotiators, with Qatar and Egypt. And I think President Biden said it very clearly that the obstacle to move forward to the release of the hostages in exchange of release of prisoners who are terrorists depends now on Hamas agreeing to do it. Meantime, the Hamas is not giving up and is continuing in its own direction. So it really depends on the Hamas. But it's important to say, Israel still has 124 people that have been kidnapped and held hostage in Gaza. Out of them, 39 are known to be dead. The rest, we do not know, because nobody has seen them since they were kidnapped into Gaza, not the Red Cross, nobody. And we have to do what we can in order to bring those people home.
Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has been invited by the U.S. Congress to address U.S. Congress next month, and he has accepted. And I'm sure the international community will be listening intently to that, to hear his plans and to see where everything will be headed. What is the Prime Minister possibly hoping to achieve in making this personal address and personally talking to its biggest ally?
So let me, you know, it's very important to say that the U.S. is a strategic ally of the State of Israel. And we see that the U.S. continuously understands and recognizes the right of Israel to defend itself against terrorists. It is important that there will be also a personal and immediate interaction with the leadership of the U.S. And this is the importance of this visit. Obviously, he's invited to address the House, but I guess and hope that he'll have also other meetings. And it is important that the messages of Israel, of the Prime Minister of Israel, would come out loud and clear, because there's a lot of disinformation and a lot of propaganda and a lot of fake news, including on the numbers of the people that have been affected in Gaza, including questions, is Israel really assisting in the entrance of humanitarian aid into Gaza? And it's important that the facts and what Israel is trying to do are known, because we are assisting as much as we can in the entrance of humanitarian assistance to Gaza. People say that there is hunger in Gaza, but you do not realize that actually these days we see 80% more food entering Gaza compared to the before October 7. So there's much more food in Gaza now than there was before the war, because we do not want a humanitarian crisis, and we want to minimize the suffering. And as I said, the Prime Minister Netanyahu engagement with the international community, especially with the United States, is extremely important and will continue to be closely coordinated with the Americans.
Finally, Mr. Ambassador, Israel is about to celebrate its 76th Independence Day. What to you is the significance of this event in the context of this war with Hamas?
Maybe it is important to mention that we celebrated our 76th anniversary for the first time in the midst of a war. We are all focused on the war in Gaza, but Israel has a war also on its northern border with Hezbollah, not a war yet, but escalations with Hezbollah on the border with Lebanon. Hezbollah is another terror organization with the same goal of annihilating the State of Israel, of destroying the State of Israel and killing the Jews. And on a daily basis, they're attacking us and our towns and villages and communities on the northern border. And there are other terror organizations from Syria, from Iraq, the Houthis from Yemen, and finally, Iranians, who have launched missile attack just 2 months ago, exactly 2 months ago, more than 300. And Israel was able to intercept 99% of the missiles and drones that were from Iran. So we are celebrating in the midst of a war. So the celebrations are very not as happy as we celebrate them every year, because of the kidnapped, because of the people who are displaced of their homes, because of the war, and because we want to see peace. So the celebrations are really not very happy, but on the other hand, it's important to say that we are also optimistic. We are resilient. We have suffered before terrorism. We have suffered wars, all of them with the same attempt of destroying the state of Israel and making it an Islamic state. And we have survived and will continue to not only survive, but to thrive for the future. And this year, most of the eyes and the prayers during our celebration of our Day of Independence are for the return of the hostages, end of the war, end of the suffering, and hopefully finding some kind of a solution which will allow us to live peacefully side by side with the Philippine, with the Palestinian people, and by that enabling economic development and building people-to-people relations. We need to build this and we need to work for it, but on the same time, we also need to counter terrorism.
Israeli ambassador to the Philippines, Ambassador Ilan Floss, thank you very much, sir, for your time.
Thank you very much.